the temple, and saw the beggar that had been there, we know, at least 40 years, 40 plus years. They didn't have money, but they said, in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. And the Bible says that he got up and walked, and he was singing and dancing, going into the temple. And now we're going to look at what happened after they made their way to the temple. We know from looking at the Bible that if anyone in here believes that being a Christian means there will be no problems in your life, then they are not familiar with the Bible. Because the Bible specifically says that. And in John chapter 15, verses 18 through 20, Jesus speaking says, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it will love you as its own, and it is you, and it is. You do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obey my teachings, they will obey yours also. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, to this you are called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. No surprise, Jesus said, they persecuted me, they will persecute you. The Bible in essence says, listen, don't be surprised when that happens. Don't act like it's something that's out of the ordinary, that something's wrong, something's messed up, because that's what it is to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, maybe we're not beaten or anything like that, but we often go through some persecutions if you stand up for Jesus Christ in your life. It can even come from those close to you, from family and friends as well, but it does happen. Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 12, it reads this. The priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, elders, and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas the high priest was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other men of the high priest family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question him, by what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified when God raised him, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone your builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, but there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look at the account of the apostles, John and Peter, being seized and being thrown into jail. And Lord, we just pray that as we look at this and as Lord, that you would draw from that some applications for us as we see what it means to be a follower of you. But Father, that we know there is no other name by which one is saved than Jesus Christ alone. Lord, we're thankful for that. Lord, I pray now that I may decrease, that you may increase in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the first thing that's happened is that the apostles are seized. Now, this is really the first opposition that the church has experienced. This is about the third sermon of Peter, but we've seen before that they really didn't run into a lot of opposition, but now opposition is beginning. And we see what happens here during this as the apostles are being seized. In Matthew chapter 13, Mark chapter 15, 13, just find a page anywhere. Just look at it. Mark chapter 13. Verses 9 through 11. Jesus said, and just want to keep this in the back of your mind as this unfolds. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. Just say what is ever given to you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. Jesus tells them ahead of time, listen, you're going to be held accountable, and you're going to be brought before judges and others to give a witness to it. Don't be so worried. Don't think ahead of time, okay, what am I going to say when this happens, when that happens? Whatever the Holy Spirit gives to you, that is what you need to say. John chapter 16, verse 2. Says, they will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, a time is coming when anyone who kills you will think he is offering a service to God. So opposition, Jesus spoke about. Back in Acts chapter 4, let's look at the participants in the seizing of the apostles. It said the priest, which is probably the priest, local priest there in Jerusalem, leadership, if you will, the captain of the temple, well, you may want to look at it as the police chief. Besides the high priest, he carried the most power. Even though this was over Rome, police chief carried power within the temple of the temple guard. And the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. Now the Sadducees are a unique group. You hear in the New Testament Sadducees and Pharisees, but you hear far more about the Pharisees than you really do the Sadducees. They are a sect that, first of all, they don't believe in the resurrection. They don't really believe in spiritual things like an angel in the spiritual world. They don't believe that an individual will receive a reward or punishment after this life here on the earth. So there are unique, there's a lot more about the Sadducees, but they are a unique group. They are very educated. They are very wealthy. They had built sort of friendship somewhat with Rome. Again, Rome was the leadership here. They realized that they needed to build some kind of relationship here for their own protection. And so they carried a great deal of power. And throughout Acts, all the time that the church and the apostles are getting persecution, you can bet that there's Sadducees somewhere nearby that has a part in that. And they will do whatever they need to do to keep their power. If you ever known somebody that's like that, that they're not going to lose their power. Have you ever been in a situation that there's a power struggle? It can be pretty devastating. And the Sadducees knew that they were sort of the top dog, and that Rome had allowed them to have quite a bit of power, and they were not about to lose it. So keep that in mind now as we see this unfolding. Jesus sort of told us about the Sadducees. Mark chapter 12, verse 24. Jesus replied, Are you not in error because you do not know the Scriptures or the power of God? Jesus sort of laid out, you don't even know the Scripture. Are you not in error? You don't know the power of God. But understand this, they knew about their own power and was not going to let it go. Now the premise of the apostles being arrested. In verse 2, they were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. We already told you that they don't believe in the resurrection. So the premise by which they used to arrest them, keeping in mind their number one goal was they were not going to lose power, and these guys were starting to get some power, and people were starting to follow them, and they had to shut it down. First of all, they were unqualified teachers. That's what they were saying about the apostles. In Acts chapter 4, verse 13, it says, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. See, these guys were very influential. They had money, they were educated, and they said, listen, these hillbillies, but I don't know how you fit all that into them. But these uneducated people are beginning to teach. They can't teach. We're educated. We're smart. We have been to all the schools. They haven't been to these schools. They don't, let's say it like this, they haven't been to seminary. What are they doing teaching? So they say, first of all, we're arresting them because we have unqualified teachers. They're just not that smart. They shouldn't be teaching and saying the things they are saying. They were also talking about a very unpopular person. And we see here in verse 2, they were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus. They were talking about Jesus. These are the same people that had Jesus killed. So Jesus, in essence, it's that Jesus is becoming very popular because more and more people are following the new church. But as far as they were concerned, these apostles were talking about a very unpopular person, Jesus Christ. They had to put a stop to it. And then they were doing, sort of based also on that, not very knowledgeable, not qualified, they were talking about an unacceptable teaching. That Jesus, the one that they had killed, they had done away with, and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. Say, so, oh man, now they're teaching something that's just unacceptable. That's just wrong in their eyes. So that was the premise at which the apostles were arrested. Verse 3, we see the punishment. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. Because of the custom of the time, there was no trial at night, and so they were seized and put in jail. And then the people. Now, watch what happens. All this takes place. Verse 4 says, but many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. If you remember the first time we heard about that the church had 3,000 converts. I don't really know why, maybe we'll ask our professor. But they didn't really, in the New Testament, they didn't count women. They just sort of count men. So at 3,000, back earlier, you may guesstimate about 8,000 people. Here we have 5,000. You talk about wives and maybe children, you're getting around 15,000. So the growth was very, very strong, happening very, very quick. And oftentimes when there is punishment or someone is being mistreated, there is growth in that area. And it seems like the blood of the martyrs has always been the growth of the church. People grow, and these people had accepted the message, and they were growing. So again, keep in mind, the Sadducees, we got to stop it. We're trying to stop it over here, and it's growing over here. We're in a pickle, you might say. I don't know if that's a Sadducee term or not, but anyway. They found themselves in a pickle trying to stop this movement from happening. This is also the last time in Acts you will actually see the number of the growth. It'll just say from now on, so they added a lot. There was a lot more. Many came, things like that. Because really, I think it just got so big, they probably just couldn't keep count. Just a challenge of counting all that. So we have the apostles being seized. Then we have the apostles before the Sanhedrin. In verses 5 and 6, we look at the participants or the Sanhedrin. And they were sort of the high court, the supreme court of that day. And in verses 5 and 6, it says this. The next day, the rulers, elders, and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. So we see who part of that group was. It was 71 men made up of high priests. Annas, the high priest, was there. And so were Caiaphas, also another priest that was there. They were part of that Sanhedrin that made up that Supreme Court, if you will. It also talked about here that it was elders. And elders could be leaders of prominent families. Also, there were scribes, which could, I'm sure, have many Pharisees in it. There also were teachers of the law. So all of these were made up of that Supreme Court, if you will. It says John and Alexander and the other men of the high priest family. We don't know who this John and Alexander is. They're never mentioned again in the Bible, but anyway, their name were mentioned here. Now we see the pro. Verse 7, they had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them, by what power or what name did you do this? Now, this is sort of a half circle, and then John and Peter would be right in the middle of them, and they were throwing out these questions to the two of them. Keep in mind, the thought, we're not going to lose our power. We got to do something about this. Now, the way it is written in the Greek, you could almost say it like this in verse 7. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question him, by what power or what name did you do this? Like, man, we already know you're not very smart. We know you're unschooled. How did you do something like this? Very degrading with the question. So they asked him, and then Peter, I think, almost said, I'm glad you asked. Wouldn't it be neat if, you know, sometimes we're at work or at other places and we won't tell someone what Jesus is doing. Sometimes it's hard to get sort of introductory, isn't it? Sort of getting started, get the conversation going. And you hope that somebody just comes to you and say, hey, tell me about Jesus or your church. Well, that doesn't happen very often. Usually we talk with someone and all of a sudden something comes up and you're able to do this. Wouldn't it be great that if in many times that you had an introduction like this, tell me about what makes your life, and what name, what power gives you the ability to get through life and get through some tough times. Man, I'll tell you what, I wish I had that introduction quite a bit. That's great. Let me tell you. Or Peter's message, he says this, then Peter, don't miss this, filled with the Holy Spirit. Do you remember what Peter did when Jesus was on trial? Remember, he was in the camp and he was watching to see what happened, and people came up to him and said, hey, aren't you that one that was with him? Not me. Remember, somebody else came up, I think I remember seeing you. Aren't you? No, not me. Somebody else did that, and he said, it is not me. I do not know the man. He denied Jesus three times. Remember that? Have you ever denied Jesus? You know, I don't know if I've done it so much with the spoken word. Boy, sometimes with your life, we deny it. And remember, when Jesus came back, he wanted to be sure that he found Peter. Now, this same one that denied Jesus, first of all, in my humanness, if I was Jesus and someone denied me going through that, I don't know how quick I'd be to reconcile that relationship. I mean, if I found out that somebody said very, very derogatory statements about me, or, you know, I don't know how quick I'd reconcile that. I would think, let's let them own up to it or something. So, in looking at lies, man, when we deny Jesus, it's crushing, isn't it, for a believer? There is nothing I don't think more crushing than to deny Jesus Christ, either through our spoken word or through our actions. And man, it hurts. So how does Peter, now able to stand up, and this is the third sermon, and preaching and telling these people what happened? Well, we have it here. Peter filled with the Holy Spirit. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. Folks, listen. One of the tragedies that Satan does to God's people is this. Satan likes to remind us of when we've let God down, doesn't he? And about the time that you're really beginning to make strides and walking closer with God and doing things for God, Satan's always there to say, hey, don't forget who you are. And don't forget that there are some people that know who you are. So quit playing this game with Jesus and accept who you are, and you're never going to be one of those real good followers of Jesus. And if we're not careful, we can start working in the family of God and powerful, doing things for God. And this song, get up for Jesus. You start get up, Satan says, hold on here, big boy. Let me remind you of this, 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 and this. And you go over. We know this, God has forgiven our sins. Amen? If you sin on the way here, God has forgiven that. If you sin on the way home, God has forgiven that. And it is the Holy Spirit that comes within you and says, yes, you're exactly right. I was a sinner. I did disobey God. I did deny Jesus Christ, but no more. For I live my life as best I can to not deny Him anymore. In my words or in my actions. So Peter starts out saying, listen, it is the Holy Spirit. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers, elders of the people. So his spirit. And then he was sensible in this. If we are being called to encounter today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed. He said, really? In essence, I think that's what Peter said. Really, you're calling me to give an account? Because this crippled man that you know has been crippled for over 40 years. He was at the gate of your temple. He's been there. Everybody knows him. And now you're asking me to give an account today for an act of kindness? Is that really why you got me here? And then Peter talks about the strength. I like this. Then know this. Okay. You asked for it. Here it is. Know this. You and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. I like it because the paralyzed man was right there with him. Now, I'm sure there was some thought that the Sanhedrin was thinking, hey, you guys have sort of worked this thing out together. You know, give us a sleight of hand. There's some kind of trickery here because you're trying to build momentum for your cause, which we're trying to stop. But he says, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Now, remember, Peter has this. There's a boldness in all these sermons in the New Testament. There is a boldness from the preachers. Peter doesn't get up and say, and we see it in his other sermons, he don't get up and say, oh, I better not say that, I'll make them mad. Oh, I better not do that. There is a boldness here that is so strong. There was a a Methodist minister that went around. His name was Peter Cartwright. I think it was in Chicago, but I could be wrong. And he had a tendency to preach exactly what God laid on his heart. Didn't matter who it was, didn't matter who was there, he was going to tell it like it is. Well, one morning, the leadership of the that was with Peter Cartwright found out that President Andrew Jackson was in the crowd. And they thought, oh, it is no telling what Peter's going to say here. So they got with him and said, listen, be very careful what you say. You don't want to offend the president. Andrew Jackson is here in the crowd listening to you. So be very careful. So he got up and he said, basically, I have been forewarned to tell you that I need to be very careful what I say today. Because in our presence is President Andrew Jackson. And he said, then he followed that up with, Andrew Jackson will go to hell if he don't repent. Everyone was astonished. They had no idea of what Andrew Jackson was going to say about that. And I don't have the exact words, but Andrew Jackson talked to Peter Cartwright after and said, if I had more men like you, I'd be able to equip any nation that I need. But there's boldness in the word. And here, Peter says, in verse 10, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. And then he says some sort of odd words. It's coming from Psalm chapter 118, verse 22. But here in Acts chapter 4, verse 11, he says, "Here is a stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone." Psalm 118, verse 22 says it like this: "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." In building the temple for Solomon, it was a seven-year process. The stones for the wall were built in the quarry. There was no hammering up there at the temple, and they built the stones. They were all exactly the same, and then it was brought up to be put up to make the wall for King Solomon. The story goes that one time during this time of getting those stones up, again, all the same, all exactly the same, they got a stone up there that was not the right size. It was just wasn't the right size. Well, they looked at it and they realized this had to be an error or something. So they basically took the stone and just rolled it down the hill because it was of no value to them. Because it did not match the other stones. It didn't lay where it needed to. And then when they got to the end, they sent word down to the quarry, "We need the cornerstone now." The quarry said, "We have sent that up to you some time back." Nobody said, "Where? We don't know." And they say, the story goes that there was an older worker there that said, "You remember that stone that we said was a mistake, that was no good, that we rolled down the hill?" So they went down, they got it, and they had to clean it off and brought it back up, and it fit perfectly as the cornerstone. All Jewish people would know that story of the cornerstone, of the stone that was pushed away, worthless, no good, of no value, didn't mean a thing to what they were trying to accomplish. Every Jew knew that story. And then here, Peter said, "The stone you builders rejected, which has now become the cornerstone, is none other than Jesus Christ." You rejected him. He is the cornerstone. He is the Messiah. He is the power. He is the strength. And then he goes on to say, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." Now we'll look at just a moment. In Psalm 118, verse 22, notice this: "The stone the builders rejected." The stone the builders rejected. When you look at it in 4 verse 11, Acts 4 verse 11, "The stone you builders rejected." Boy, that hits right home, doesn't it? You reject. Friends, listen, when we're talking to our family, friends, co-workers, trying to build a relationship, I hope your goal, one of your goals in life, is to bring others to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Has he changed your life? Is your life different today than it was before? Now, it doesn't mean, are you not going through some issues? It doesn't mean that at all. But is your life different since you met the cornerstone? That maybe, in your testimony, you can say, "There was a time that I rejected that." But he's changed your life. Man, you look on the news now, and Liz and I was talking, I guess it comes a little more real to us. I don't remember if it's the news or what, but it's a picture of about a 2-year-old boy that that is missing, but they believe that he's been healed. And there we go. There's so much other things in the world that are so tough. And you work and you have friends and you have people on the highways and byways of your life that are struggling with life and have no hope. And I think there's nothing more challenging or more devastating or more hurting than when you know there's someone that is near you or around you that has lost hope. See, before I accepted the cornerstone, I understood that problem. So if I'm going to tell someone what a difference their life can be, it's got to be in the name of Jesus. We must tell them about Jesus Christ, the cornerstone that was rejected. So, I close with verse 12. Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to man by which we must be saved. There's a beautiful song that goes, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. I'm so glad I know Him as my Savior, and I trust You. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You for this day. We thank You for the power of Your name, Father God. Lord, we pray for those, that person that's nearest to the steps of hell this morning, Father God. May someone tell them about the name of Jesus. And Father God, this week, if You lay on our hearts someone that we need to tell about the name of Jesus, Father God, give us the strength to do that. Give us the power to do that. Let us tell them about the only one. No other name by which you shall be saved than the name of Jesus. Lord, in that, we know You'll be well pleased. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll be standing at